All right. Well, it's been a tumultuous 24 hours, to say the least. I put up almost 300 pictures of Sri Sri Ananda My Ma on Facebook that most of us have never seen before. It's just a mind blower. And you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of likes, just and friend requests just pouring in. It's just, you know, it's just a massive. But I want it to be more. I want it to be millions. You know, I can handle millions of friend requests actually. And so that's happening right now. And Everything's happening right now, isn't it? Everything's happening right now. I want it to be a ma mania throughout the world. A ma mania, you know, sweep the whole world so we all get pulled out of this trap that's been set in the world. If you know what this trap is, you know what I'm talking about. It's a very, very clever trap. And I might be the only person in the world talking about it right now. It doesn't mean it's not there. It means that people want an audience, and the audience has been trained to, you know, boo and hiss when this is brought up. So if you want an audience, you don't talk about it. But in the long run, that's the wrong approach. So we have to talk about it here, because it's what's going on here in the world. It's what's going on. There's a trap. I call it the lust, hate, fear trap. The lust, hate, fear trap. And the fact is that there are two bullies fighting each other right now, okay? Two bullies. The people say Trump's a bully, yeah. But the left is every bit as much, if not quite more of a bully than Trump is, actually. So you have these two bullies in a dogfight. And what this is doing is it's attracting everyone's attention, getting pulled into attitudes, reptilian attitudes, it's called lust, fear, hatred. And these actually are like emanations. It's dream emanations, yes. But with all these, really it's doubt, the toxicity of doubt. But here's the weird thing about this dream we call a cosmos. It is a fact that what we call, there are certain entities, like parasites, gain a sense of power through through lust, fear, and hatred. These emanations, okay, it's like a super drug to them, an ego drug, and it's what they feel sustains the whole universe, the dream. Well, it kind of is, isn't it? I mean, that's what sustains doubt. Really, it's familiarity that sustains it, continuity fear. But from their standpoint of thinking that they want to feel superior to others. So getting all this doubt, emotionalism, called the reptilian brain, it causes them, it makes them feel superior. Like they're better, you know, they're greater, they're stronger. It boosts their ego, so to speak. Like, yeah, this dream is real, or yeah, this doubt is real, and we're the king of doubters, that kind of thing. The reptilians have a reputation in the cosmos for being this way. So they're like, it's like parasites, and we're the host. So the issue in this world right now, as foretold by many prophets and seers, is this what's called the end times, and this where this planet has actually become like colonized by the reptilians who want to use us like livestock. We're like livestock right now. They've trained us to be their livestock, like a cow producing milk. We're now producing lust, hatred, and fear for them, and they milk us for that. They milk us for that, and this actually makes them feel superior to God. They think they're superior to God. It gives them this tremendous egoic kind of feeling. And they're addicted to it, like a parasite. They're very, very addicted to it. And those who have ears who have heard the warnings about this and notice what's going on in the world, and I certainly did, and I paid great attention to it and saw exactly how it works. And this is exactly what's happened in the world right now. And the world has been conditioned, steadily conditioned. They're very, very expert at turning us into cows, okay? Secreting the milk, toxic milk of lust, hatred, and fear for them. And so the movies, the movie industry, the media, okay, entertainment industry, pop culture, all the modern values are really a reptilian conditioning, actually. And now you have these people who simply, they just generate this, constantly generating this vibe, you know, of doubt, of hatred. And what they want is they want us to all be, you know, at each other's throats, actually. And then, you know, peddling lust along with that, which exacerbates the entire problem. So it's extremely important to stay away from that. It's extremely important. Now, no one was stricter than Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma when it came to being scrupulous about your life and staying away from all of that. If she was so strict that the Westerners couldn't handle it. They couldn't even meet the standard. Could not even meet the standard. But Indians were able to, because they had a much more conservative wisdom culture that realized how purity is very important in all ways in your life. Very, very important. Keeps the reptilians away, for one thing, which is extremely important. There's nothing they hate more than a very strictly pure, religiously conservative, pure, moralistically strict, no lust, no hatred, no fear. This is like, you spend your time, you know, in prayer and love of God, and the reptilians hate that, you know. It makes them feel weak. they start losing the belief that they're superior. And they think that's their annihilation. They think that God created them to be the rulers of this dream of doubt. That's their belief system, that they're the rulers of this dream of doubt. But the only way that they can prop this delusional belief up is to have all these slaves actually they live off like parasites off of those, producing this feeling of inferiority, like I'm full of hatred, I'm full of fear, I'm full of lust, I've got an animal, you know. This feeds their belief that they're superior, which feeds their belief that this dream is somehow reality and God created it all. You see how that works? So they're bad news all the way around. And they targeted this planet, they've colonized it, they've brainwashed it, they've conditioned it. And now you have this massive polarization going on. And I tell everybody I say boycott the world. When I mean boycott the world, partly it means don't pay any attention to it, what's going on. Don't pay attention to any dogfights that are going on. Don't engage in any dogfights, any arguments, even discussions. There's no discussion about it whatsoever. Okay, it's very bad, period. Okay, to get free of doubt, to really be liberated from doubt, is a very difficult enterprise. You can get glimpses of it, but to be actually truly liberated from it, you have to see the absolute sameness of beyond what we can explain. And you can't have this polarization. You cannot have I'm better than you, superiority, the idea of levels in the dream and all that kind of stuff. That's all nonsense. There are no levels at all in a dream. So when I say, you know, the summer of 17 is a dangerous, dangerous time, summer of hate, I mean, everybody's being pulled into it, just about. And I may be, you know, maybe I don't have any audience, no one listening to me at all. But, you know, I'm sticking to what I have to say. It's right. The Dharma Kings have shown me, schooled me, mentored me in wisdom. I understand the big picture and how important it is to stick with that and understand that our habits matter. Our habits matter, actually. Because if we're not strict, we will get sidetracked by some story of imagination that that is still part of the dream of doubt, and will think it's important and it's relevant, instead of seeing it has no value at all, has no value, and will be part of the problem. So this is what's taking place right now. In other words, this trap is being sprung upon the world right this instant. You must be dispassionate. You must be dispassionate. Okay. And so these reptilian infiltrators, they're very clever at infiltrating. They've infiltrated so many, many, many worlds, actually, and use them the way parasite uses, like a forest. You know, they see a parasite, see a forest of trees, and say, oh boy, here's a great territory for us to move in. They're just waiting for us. And they're, you know, they're addicts. They're total addicts. They're suffering from extremely bad continuity fear, believing that somehow they're supposed to be the lords of this dream of doubt. And so they see this world, and they say, oh boy, you know, another world to corrupt. And that's what they've done. That's what they've done. So our job is to turn away from that, turn away from that. So I poured out 300 divine pictures of Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, the most divine being that's ever been in this world, in terms of, you know, in terms of pictures that we have, for sure, along with Ram Maharshi. In modern times, we have pictures of them, you see. And certainly, she never ever had deviated from reality or truth. That's extremely rare. That's an avatara, who she said she's never had any karma. She's never even entered this dream at all before in terms of appearing. She's just fresh, straight from the heart of reality, the grace of God appearing here, and so. To like I said, I would not trade all the money in the world and all the power in the world and all the fame and everything. I would not trade her pictures for that money and power and fame at all. No way. They're priceless. They're absolutely priceless. Absolutely priceless. So I urge everyone to share these photo albums I put up on Facebook. Share them with everyone. Just share, and tell them, please share this, and spread that throughout the world, so people can turn to that and say, you know what, I'd rather look at her picture than a dogfight. And I was listening to this interview of a surfer, and who had some wipeout and got injured, and the press, there's all this press there. And all they wanted to know was about his blood, you know, his injuries. And he said, don't you want to know about, you know, all this other stuff that happened? They said, no. People love injury and gore and you know, all this kind of stuff. He says, that's what sells. We're not interested in the other stuff. And so I boycott the news. You know, I boycott politics. I boycott all that stuff. You know, total boycott. Because it's super essential that we set the right example for everyone else. The reptilians are ruthless. They're ruthless parasites. They're like boar beetles. You know, I mean, they bore in, and they spread their toxicity throughout the whole system, systematically spread it, and then they scream, you know, enraged if you try to do something about it, like as if their universe is coming to an end. Well, it will come to an end. It never began. There is no universe. A dream is not a universe. A dream of a universe is really not a universe, actually. It's nothing at all. It's nothing at all. So they have to, you know, they have to. We cannot give them any courtesy calls anymore. We cannot make courtesy calls anymore. Because they have to be stopped. They have to be stopped. And we have to stop them ourselves by refusing to produce the lust, the hatred, the fear that they feed off of, that makes them feel that they're welcome and that they belong here. They're supposed to be here. And they, you know, it's all that stuff. That's why if you invoke Christ or the inner truth, God, the Holy Spirit, the Dharma, whatever you want to call it, to these parasites, they shrink back in fear, you know, and it's like, stay away from me, you know, kryptonite, no, we don't want purity, we want decadence, we want degenerate decadence, that's what they want. In a dream, it's possible to imagine really crazy stuff, and they literally believe that this, you know, empowers them, keeps them in power, okay, keeps them as the lords of the dream. Because here are these, you know, struggling, fearful, hateful, lustful humans. And they can, it makes them feel superior, and it also strengthens doubt, you know, in them. See, they think that they're the lords of doubt, so they want doubt to be real. You see, if doubt wasn't real, what meaning would lords of doubt have? It wouldn't have any meaning at all, would it? So they want us to showcase doubt for them. Okay, that's the trip they're on. They want us to be severe doubters. And they want us to turn away from certainty. So we're looking for the remedy for this. We're looking for the remedy for this. And it continues. Sri Sri Anandamayi certainly has the remedy, and we don't know exactly how she will play her card, but it will be played at some point. And she left no doubt about it. It is the kind of life you're supposed to live here. I mean, she's really schooled me in so many, many, many ways to change my life, change my habits, change everything. And I said that, you know, she's right. She's right. You know, she's never wrong. So, you know, we may think we can argue with it, but, you know, there's no, it's useless. It's useless. Same with Jesus, you know, the religions teach the truth in terms of being very scrupulous about your habits, staying away from degradation and decadence, absolutely staying away from that. It's forbidden. It's absolutely forbidden because it attracts, like a toxic perfume, it attracts these villains, you might say, of the dream. They're very much villains of the dream. And invites them and attracts them and allows them. It's like your house gets flooded and attracts mold, doesn't it? It attracts mold. You don't want your house to be flooded. It's going to get all moldy. So we've allowed our house to be flooded. And lo and behold, it's all this mold is everywhere. So you need some restoration experts to come in and clean it up. It's got to be cleaned up. Clean up the swamp. The swamp has to be cleaned up. Otherwise, most certainly, we will just be enslaved here, as most already are, actually, in their habits. They're already enslaved. And all they can do is rationalize it, you know. They say, no, this is the way God meant for me to be, you know. I need to be decadent. That's good for me. Well, that's what the reptilians have told them. And they think the reptilians are these high lords or God, you know, of this dream of doubt. But of course, there's no such thing as doubt. So how could there be layers and levels of what doesn't exist, actually? That's kind of silly, isn't it? The last will be first, the first will be last, and the last will be first. This is true in so many, many ways. As long as you think that there's higher and lower, you're going to be last, you know. But when you put your, realize there's no way I can be higher, you know. There's no higher, so I'm just the lowest. Accept this that belief and doubt is just lowliness, you know. I mean, it's complete delusion. There's no greatness to it at all. There's none, zero. Then you'll be the first in the kingdom of heaven, like that. You'll realize the truth quickly. So we don't know exactly what'll happen, but that was quite an experience, posting all at once 300 pictures and three albums on Facebook. And of course the devotees of Sri Sri Nan Mai Ma are just like, you know, it's just tremendous for them, which is great. It's extremely profound. I mean, look at those pictures, and you have to believe in God. You know, you can't not believe in God by looking at those pictures. You have no choice. I came across a picture of someone who followed me on Facebook. I checked out his timeline, you know, his home page, and he had as his profile picture this picture of Sri Sri Nan Mai Ma. I'd never seen it before. It was absolutely amazing. It was like perfect. It was just perfect. I mean, you cannot imagine such a being here in this world. You cannot. Same with Rama Maharshi. Try as you might, I can't help but just be amazed. Even after 20 years, it's still just as amazing. I say, this is just absolutely amazing. Beyond amazing. There's no, you know, there's no even word for it. And that's why we just sit and just are quiet. You know, it's just, it's straight to the heart. You know, it is straight to the heart of our identity. Because really, she is our identity. Our identity came into this world without any doubt whatsoever. Our identity showed up in this world and moved a body around with no doubt at all about the fact that it is our identity. No doubt about it at all. Even going through all living here in the world, still doing that. And that is just, you know, you can't get any better than that. That is, in terms of grace, it's so extraordinary. It just leaves us all dumbfounded, actually. But unmistakably, when I look at her picture, I say that is me. That is what I am, and that is what you are, and all of us. This is what we are. No question about it. This is the truth of what we are. There's no doubt about what we are at all. Now, yesterday, I had sort of what you call a transmission from her, and people say, well, she died. Someone said, well, she died, and I'm so sorry she died, and she's gone. It's been so long. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. See, for me, I am sure she never died. Never died. How could she die? It's impossible. And so what she told me is, she said, I didn't leave the world. The world left me. The world left me, and intuitively, I saw it. I saw what she's talking about. I said, wow. That is amazing. It is true. Just as she said, I didn't come into the world. The world saw me. She says, I'm always present, but the world wanted to see me for a while. So it saw me for a while. And then it decided it wanted to leave me for a while. So it left me for a while. And in our dreaming, she appeared to age and die. But she didn't really age and die. I mean, in a dream, it can appear that way, can't it? But factually, she did not age and she didn't die. How can reality age and die? It cannot. So, and I recount this story that was written, and it wasn't just one devotee. It happened to many. When she was old, they were looking at her, and suddenly all the age would just completely disappear. And they saw her as just this radiant, you know, youthful-like being. And it lasted for them for quite some time, maybe a day or so. I mean, that's how this... And then they finally asked her, you know, what's going on? And she just plainly told them, she said, look, the world... The habits of dreaming, the habits of karma, which is really dreaming, of doubt, are such of the world that they expect me to age and die. And that's what they are seeing. That's what they're seeing. But she says, really, what you saw me the way I really am, You don't have to. She said, you don't have to see me that way. You don't have to see me age. You don't have to see me die. But if that's what you are dreaming, that you believe you have to see that to keep the believing in this in doubt and dreaming, that's what you will see. So that's why she told me, I didn't leave the world. The world left me. But guess what? You don't have to go along with the world. So from the moment I laid eyes on her, I said, ah, you're here, you're alive. And then I found out, well, she died in, 1982. And I said, no, that's not true. So I never believed that she died. And I said, I'll see her someday, for sure I will see her someday. And because she cannot die, actually. So this is a profound truth that in a dream, we can dream of a dream death, and it will absolutely be certain that she aged and died. We're certain of it. But it's just a dream. Okay? So it's not real. It's not real. And just because the world expects that, and therefore conventionally almost everyone dreams that's what happened to her. This is the power of our imagination. We dream that of this. And yes, even in photographs would show it too, because photographs are also a dream, part of the dream. It's what we want to see. But actually, there was a photograph of her, and maybe quite a few, that captured stuff that no one else saw, but some people saw that they said, when they were present, they said, I saw her look like this, and actually the photograph actually showed it, that she looked very different. It's amazing. So we can't simply not believe in that dream of aging and death. Not believe in it. I don't believe in it. I don't believe in it at all. Never have. So for me, she's here. She's still here, just as much as ever. And it's only my, doubting that, which means I can't see her. It's only my doubt that's the problem. Okay, that's it. And she could very well appear. She could very well appear. For those who want to see her, she could very well appear, actually, who cast aside this nonsense that somehow our being, eternal life, is somehow subject to aging and death. That's utter nonsense. That's simply trying to cast doubt upon reality, okay, which is what this whole dream of conditioned existence is all about, trying to cast doubt on reality. I had a dream of her about a week ago or so, where I gave her this dollar bill, but it looked like, why was it a dollar bill? Because it was a picture, a portrait, piece of paper with the portrait on it, so I thought it was a dollar bill. And then she gave me change, all these coins, and coins have portraits on them too, but then she threw them at me, and it scattered everywhere on the ground. And then she walked off laughing, and the way she is just, it's just totally in the now. In the flow of now, with no thought of anything other than the flow of the now. There's no such thing as past or future at all. And I realized that she wanted me to scatter these pictures of her all over the world. I was holding on to them. I didn't know what to do with them. I prayed to her. I said, I don't want these on my hands. I want people to have these. I don't know what to do, how to do it. And so what happened was, suddenly my hard disk, where I store all my everything, it's an external hard drive, terabyte, it started to malfunction and actually crashed, and I said, oh my gosh, I've lost everything. I lost all their pictures. But I remained calm and I just prayed, and I said, I pray that I can get them back, but if I do, I got to do something right away with them. And so suddenly the hard drive began functioning again, but very intermittently. It kept crashing over and over and over. I said, oh gosh, I said, immediately I tried to post all these pictures on Facebook, but it crashed. I got one album up, 100 pictures, but the second one crashed. And so then I just tried again and let it go all night long, and it succeeded. But then I realized I can copy the files from the hard drive onto like a memory card, a 64 gig memory card. So I did that to safeguard them. And then from the memory card, I upload them to Facebook. So I got them all up onto Facebook. And then I said, and then she tricked me again. I thought I was uploading them to the intensive private group. And somehow they got on my main timeline page. And so she was able to orchestrate me getting these pictures into the to the public without any holds barred, you know, just freely distributing them to everybody. Where I was trying to think about maybe I'll give them out one at a time over, like, you know, it'll last for a year, you know, one every day or something, that kind of thing. And she didn't want that. She didn't want that. She said, I want it to be a blitzkrieg of divine grace, prasad for the world, and just, you know, everyone to have them. Now, the issue that I found among devotees, almost all of them are Indian, is they see her as their mother. Indians tend to adore their mothers. I found this out, which for Western I find that kind of odd, you know. But they really, I mean, wow, they just are like they're always a child. To their mother, they feel that they're a little child always. And, you know, I don't feel that way at all in relation to mothers at all. In fact, I don't really like mothers, actually. Not at all. But they love their mothers. So to them, she's like their mother, especially if their mothers have passed away. It's when they look at her, they're reminded of their mother. Now, this is all very well and good, but the mother, the role is the protective, very predictable, you know, in terms of the child knows what to expect from the mother. That's why the child feels so comfortable and trusting, because the child knows he calls, the mother will come, the mother will do this, and the mother is very, very, very steady and predictable and does what the child expects. But that limits the mother, doesn't it, to a certain role. So what Sri Sri Anandamayi said was she suggested to us that we see her as our sister, our little sister. She'd say, or she says, if you want a little daughter, if you're married, you want to see me as your family, a little daughter, if you want to look at me that way. But she said, if she'd rather have us look at her as our little sister or our friend. But little sister is the one she seemed to really harp on. And I see her as my little sister. And why? Because your little sister can be very unpredictable, you see, right? You don't expect your little sister to be totally predictable, do you? You don't know what she's going to do, but she's adorable. No matter what she does, she's so adorable, she gets away with it. But your mother is, the way you view your mother is completely different than the way you view a little sister. Little sister might do stuff that makes you laugh, and it's, I never thought anyone would do something like that. She might, you know, pratfall this, or you don't know. I mean, but it's okay. She could get away with it. So, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, she would do so many things, so creative to get you to do stuff the right way, go the right way, and sometimes people get mad at her, you know, if they thought she was their mother, they get frightened, says, you know, but my mother wouldn't do that. And then, she'd cry and say, well, just think of me as your little sister, daughter, and she'd play the little girl thing, and it would melt their hearts, and they'd forgive her, because she does stuff like crashing my hard drive, you know? It's like, oh my gosh, I just lost the last, you know, 20 years of my life, or 15 years, everything is there. But I didn't panic. I still calmed. I said, you know, I hope I don't lose those pictures. They're very precious. A lot of work. And so I could forgive her, you know, for doing that. So my little sister played a a trick on me, you know, and she sort of tricked me into getting those pictures up. But I say that's great, little sis, that's great. You know, I'm not upset with you. How can you be mad at your little sister? It doesn't last very long, does it? Because you say, well, you know, I can't really control her. I can't tell her what to do or what to expect because sometimes she gets these, you know, these flights of, she, you know, do it, I want to do it this way, and you don't know why she's that way. And so Nanda Mayama says she functions better that way. She's more helpful to us as a little sister. And I can very much understand this now. Really can. Yes, she's helpful as a mother figure, but not as helpful as seeing her as a little sister. Because then she really has the full palette of helping us. So, and you could see on this picture I saw of her, you could see it's all there. And you could see her as a mother, a daughter, a little sister, or a friend. But the little sister, it came out the strongest. It came out the strongest. It really did. But it's all there. It's all there. Those various roles. So she got me to do what she wanted me to do. And I said, well, the rest is in your hands. You know, it's up to you. It's out of my hands now. And women of the world should, you know, being so, they really are very sociable. They control social media, and they should spread it around the world. That should be their role right now. Seriously, all the women of the world should be spreading those pictures, sharing the picture albums, because as women go, so go men in this world. This is a fact. Women control the world, actually, this dream, and when they turn their attention to love and peace and away from hatred, lust, and fear, when they do that, the men realize it's okay for them to do that too. But if the women are all, you know, debauched, as most of them are these days, so many are terrible, then they expect the men to support that, you see. And the men cannot turn to moral purity. They're not able to, because the women will have ways to absolutely chop them up in little pieces, emotionally and psychologically. So it's essential that women take the lead as far as moral purity goes in the world. And saying, you know what? We're not paying any attention to all this debauchery, all this hatred, all this fighting, all this nastiness in the world. We're going to pay attention to the Sri Sri Nandamayama and realize that She is the truth. This is the truth that we're looking at, not the world, okay? Not all this stuff's going on. This stuff that's going on here is an attempt to subvert this world. And she doesn't want that for us, because she doesn't want us pulled down into that. She doesn't want us to become enslaved to this hideous play of doubt. She wants us liberated from that. So when the women go into prayer, And purity and love, spiritual love, the men follow along. They say, okay, good, we can do it too. Because they want to do it. But if the women don't want it, they won't be able to do it. Especially like in India, I'm noticing the families, oh my gosh. You know, it's in the house, the women rule. I mean, there's the mothers and the aunties and the grandmothers and the friends. The house is full of these matriarchal women. And the men are just like, holy cow. I think they need men's liberation over there, but it's not going to happen. You can tell who rules the roost there, and there's no doubt about it. They'll be swarmed by these very, you know, officious kind of women. Beautiful women, wonderful women, but they will tell you what your role is. You know, this is your role. Okay. Know your role. So the men cannot just decide to, now I'm going to do this no matter what all the women tell me to do. It doesn't work that way in India. And in most places in the world, it doesn't work that way. When you have extended families, there's always tremendous amount of mature women around to guide the children and guide all the men, telling them this is the way we want things done. So it's not really feasible for men to do this on their own. It's not possible. It's not possible. And social media, women, you know, rule it. They're extremely active in social media. And so they're the ones that have to push these pictures out into the world. They're the ones who can do it. And they should have the wisdom to do it. They should, you know, they should. And, you know, most of the women, you know, who are doing this are from India, who they still have this sense of purity, you know. It's important. It's important. It's very important. You do not want to go the way of the decadent West. That is very, very true. And, you know, some will not go for it, but there needs to be this push. Mommania throughout the world, really, because there's no better exemplar that we have or ever will have, actually. You can't have anything better than that. So I just pray that the women of the world spread those pictures all over the world and give us all an opportunity to turn away from really a hideous detour on our path to liberation, a hideous detour. You know, very nasty delay. So it's not just happenstance that I happened to come across these pictures. It was really quite extraordinary. It was the end, when I started the intensive, a 2-month intensive, November 21st through January 21st, Dharma King intensive, Sri Sri Ananda Mai Ma showed up in my dreams and said, "I'm with you. Call me the Queen of Wow. I'm going to wow you. I'm going to give you a great gift." And so I said, okay, great. And so it helped me push it through. And at the end of the intensive, she said, Google my name on YouTube. I mean, go into YouTube and search. I did, and for latest editions, and there was these three videos. Actually, it was two, but two with pictures of her. The Muncha family photos of 300 pictures I had never seen. Almost all of them I've never seen before. And I thought I'd see every picture there is of her. 300. And they were the best pictures I've ever seen of her. The best. It just mind-blowing. And she gave that to me at the end of the intensive. She said, here, now I want you to help me out with these pictures. And I said, why? What do you mean? She said, well, I want them to be available, individual pictures I can post on Facebook. So they can be spread throughout the world and people can look at a picture easily instead of a video, a slideshow video. And I also want you to crop them so some of them were like, you know, at angles and tipped this way and that way. And then the lighting was bad and, you know, they weren't corrected. No one had corrected the pictures, fine-tuned all the coloring, the lighting, the clarity, the sharpness, all that stuff. She says, I want you to make the pictures, you know, the best possible, which... I've done, you know, done this for her for 20 years. Most of the pictures on around the world probably came from my work on her pictures, and people don't know that, but I've made, you know, almost all the pictures, massive amounts of pictures available from the get-go, before the internet even started, or just when it was first getting started. And so she, you know, I've had tremendous experience doing this. So I said, well, okay, it's a lot of work having to grab these pictures. But she made it easy for me. And I was able to do it. And the results are just stunning. And now that she said, post them to the world. So they're out there now. And they're out and running. And it's mind-blowing, you know. It's just like a blessing from her to the world. And so she said she would bless the intensive, she'd bless me, and she did in a way that is just so extraordinary. I never even thought possible, you know. I thought maybe there's a few pictures that I hadn't seen before. Occasionally I come across one, and it's amazing. You know, it's just great. But 300 all at once, that never crossed my mind as possible. And again, the pictures are just, you know, you just can hardly believe it, that anyone like this has ever been in the world. But it tells you that this is a dream, and God knows it's a dream, right? For someone like that to show up in the dream, it has to be a dream. It can't, what we think we are and what we see her and know her to be, can't both be true. They cannot both be true at all. So one or the other has to be a dream. And our innermost core tells us that she portrayed the reality to us, and the belief in human beings and bodies and conditioned existence, worlds and all that. That's the dream. That's the dream, actually. That's the dream. Especially the belief in time, time, space, process, and form. That's the dream. So she said, yeah, I want 300 pictures presented in the best possible light. Will you do it for me? I know you will. And I said, of course, I'll do it for you. Yeah. Yeah. That's part of helping out the Dharma Kings, you see. Ton of experience. I've had so much experience. Last 20 years. A lot of it I've spent collecting her pictures, refinishing them, colorizing them, you know, making them available for the world. That's like one of my main projects here in this world, is to make her pictures available to the world. Because I feel this could help us out vastly, you know, vastly help us. I don't see anything else that would work. I don't see anything else working in the world right now. It's incredible. It's just amazing, right? How bereft the world is of help right now. No one is hitting it, you know, in the right way, and taking the strong enough stance. They're waffling, they're indulging, they want an audience. They want an audience, you know, and the audience today is so corrupt that, you know, they feel, well, I'll just go easy on it and stuff. But we don't have to do that. Just one look at a picture of Sri Sri and my Ma, and you're gone. I mean, you just realize, now this is it. You know, this is it. This is what I really am. This other stuff is just a dream of doubt. And why should I still extend courtesy to this dream of doubt at this point when we're under, you know, the worst assault in history, attempt to turn us into perpetual slaves, living in this perpetual swamp of lust, hatred, and fear, and teaching our children that this is what God wants for us. You know, just consider how hideous that is. And we can't fool around with courtesy calls at this point. There's no time to lose. There's no time to lose. So anything is in play. Keep in mind, this dream is completely reversible. Just like I said, she never died. She never died. We could see it. We could see her living right this moment. We could see her living just without any effects of the so-called dreaming of aging and death. Absolutely, we can. There's nothing stopping us from doing that, actually, except convention, you know, and continuity, fear, and convention. If everybody, you know, believes that you die, well, I got to go along with that. You know, that's convention. That's convention. Just like everybody believed Jesus died on the cross, and he's dead in the buried in the tomb, and then he's walking around. And most people said that's not possible. You know, the apostles were shocked. You know, it's like this is so extraordinarily shocking. Is how is this possible, right? But they're willing to go against convention, and Christians are supposed to go against convention, the belief, you know, that we're born to die, age and die. Jesus said, no, you're all like me. You'll be like me. And me, you know, he said, what we are is eternal life. Eternal life is not actually subject to the grave at all. It's not subject to the grave. And he had to go into the grave to prove this to us, because people said, well, prove it. He proved it. So, as a Christian, I think this is very helpful to look at Sri Sri Anandamayi from that standpoint and say, oh, of course she could appear again. Jesus appeared, and she could, why did Jesus appear? Because of the love that the apostles had for him, the love. They were willing to put their love for him first, which is love for God, actually, and that enabled them to interact with him in the resurrection. Same with Sri Sri Narayana, the love that we have for God, for her, enables us to see her. And those who don't have that love, perhaps they won't see her. Perhaps they won't, you see. Because I say, no, she's dead and gone. I can't see her. I can't see what's dead and gone. So even if she was present, they couldn't see her because they'd hallucinate her absence. You know, we often think that hallucination means we're seeing something. It more, really more to the point, it's we're hallucinating an absence of what's really there. Okay? We're hallucinating an absence of what's really there. But we all make the mistake of the term hallucination. We think we're seeing something there that isn't there. But we're really seeing an absence of what is there. Mostly, right? And it's amazing. My whole life I've been amazed of you know, the power of the mind here, of the selective perception, of people see what they want to see. They see what they want to see, but we don't realize that that extends to death, actually. And even aging, it actually does extend to all of that. So when we say, well, how can you love someone? Well, it's love for ourselves, love for what, for God. God, we're an idea in the mind of God. God became us. So we love God. That's the answer. We love what we are. We love what we are. So that's why we can see what we are. That's why we can experience what we are. It's the love for it that enables us, along with working on familiarity. And I told the Facebook community of Sri Sri Narayana, I told her she's going to do something big for us. I posted that like maybe four or five months ago. I said, she's showing me very strongly she's going to do something very, very powerful for us. And then, wow, she provides these almost 300 pictures of her that are just, everyone a knockout, you know, just, yeah, render you speechless, actually, if you're really connected, you see, you just render speechless. That's doing a lot for us, you know. That's just a start. She's just getting started. Okay? When I say she, I mean our true self. Our true self is just getting started in helping us. Really snatching us out of the jaws of you know, a dreadful doom, actually. And at this point, if you see her as a little sister, you can go with it. If you see her as a mother, it's going to be a problem. So, you know, it's not easy for the Indian devotees. It's a lot easier for me because I never saw her as a mother because I'm not a mother worshiper at all. Not at all. Never was. I've gotten hell for that my whole life. I just tell it like it is. I say, Mom, you know, this isn't right. You know what you're doing. You're mistaken about this. You know, you're not. You don't have any special dispensation from God to spread doubt. You know, what are you doing? So I mean, people thought I was very irreverent to women, to mothers, etc. Because the people treat them, even if they're mentally ill, then no one will say it. If they're messed up, they're full of doubt. I said, look, you need to. Clean up your habits, clean up your life. What you're saying is not true. You're lying about this, you're lying about that. That doesn't cut it with liberation at all. And people thought I was just an incredibly bad person for saying that. And they probably still do. But no, that's a friend. I mean, that's speaking the truth here. There's not one truth for us and another truth for mothers. I'm sorry. Truth, it makes no exceptions at all. So you cannot have people passing on doubt and trying to sanctify it by claiming that mothers said it was okay. That just pulls everyone down in the jaws of the reptilians, actually. And so I spoke up, you know, and I've just caught hell for it my whole life. So I had to take refuge in the Dharma Kings. They're the only ones that don't give me hell for it, you know. So I don't have a mother worshiping thing at all. I see them as just, you know, just sisters, you know, brothers, sisters of in their spirit, just like me, the same. And they have the severe doubt problems, and they have the severe continuity problems, severe bias against certainty, very severe. And a bias against certainty is exactly the same whether it comes from a man or a woman or, you know, a mother. It's exactly the same. And we have to overcome that bias. We all have to overcome that bias. I don't care if you're a mother or not. It makes no difference. It makes no difference. And here we all cut mothers so much slack, they can do no wrong. They can do no wrong. Of course they can do vast wrong. The more we can say they can do no wrong, the more wrong they do. But if we call them to repentance and say, you are not special. Mothers aren't special to God. What are you talking about? God didn't make bodies at all. Bodies serve doubt, the dream of doubt, and nothing more than that. So there's no specialness to mothers in God. All are equal in God. All are equally free. So mothers are called to repentance the same as everyone else. There's no double standard. We cannot make a double standard. And I don't at all. And this, you know, upsets people. Right? It does. They just don't want to listen to me. They say, oh, you know, I can't handle that. So, you know, I've never been able to make headway to say to the Indians, saying, you know, see her as your little sister. It's mother for them. Okay. But again, for me, I don't have that problem. I don't have that problem. So it's a lot easier for me to see her living, you know, living. Just my little sister. I'll adopt her as my little daughter or something. I could do that. Adopt her. Have already adopted her as my little sister. I don't know if you can adopt someone as a little sister, but why not? It's all a dream. Why not adopt her as a little sister? So she is my little sister. Literally, I feel that way. She's part of my family, and she's my little sister. And what a little sister to have, you know, because you never know what she's going to do. And she can do anything. She can do anything. And her creativity is beyond our imagination. It really is. How she's able to do it is a mystery to us, you know. It's just that she has all creativity in all directions simultaneously. And what she can accomplish, we cannot even imagine what she can accomplish for us. We cannot. She could set the whole world right if we wanted her to, actually. If we allowed it, she could do it. No question about it. But if we stick with convention of our bias against certainty, then we'll hallucinate the absence of any effectiveness, you know. But we don't have to hallucinate the absence of it. She can actually set the entire world right for us, and we could see it. And literally it's so. If we give up our bias against certainty, and if we stop hallucinating the absence of this, you know. Again, hallucination is more hallucinating an absence of what's there. So she literally could set the whole world right for us. And in fact, I would say she will. She will. But others won't see it. They don't understand why does everything feel so perfect. You say, well, it is. I don't see that at all, because they're hallucinating an absence of that. They're hallucinating an absence of it. Jesus the same way. All the Dharma kings the same way. But she had this particular knack, because she said she's a little girl, of getting away with everything. You know, she could get away with expedience that others, we'd get frightened. You know, if Jesus does something, whoa, wait, you're Jesus. You know, we expect you to be like this. But she's like this wild card, like a little girl, and just a carefree, happy little totally carefree little girl. And she, you know, whatever she does, we say, oh, it's so adorable, you know. And we don't get mad. We don't get mad at her. So she has this, I feel, has this capability. It's like a wild card capability where she's probably able to accomplish more for us than any of the Dharma kings, actually. Because of this, we don't really, if you don't pin her into any role, sky's the limit. The sky is the limit, you know. In other words, there's no limit. She could even, what she often did was she'd just start crying hysterically, like a little girl crying, and just her heart broken. And those who were really mad with her, they couldn't stay mad with her. They could not. And they finally relented. This happened many, many times. And they just said, okay, you know, I'll do it your way. I'm sorry. You know, I relent. And their attitudes would soften and boom, gone. And they would, you know, do it her way, and it would work out fabulous for them. She used all these ploys, and they work. They really, really work. This is irresistible, actually. You know, to feel like your little daughter is just heartbroken, and she would cry rivers of tears, and it would go on for hours and hours. You know, it just shocked people, and they couldn't take it anymore. I had a dream where she did that to me, where I got to this apex, in this ladder that went up into the sky. I climbed all the way to the top, to the very top, the apex of it, and then suddenly this young woman appeared. And she just burst into tears, and she was inconsolable, just inconsolable. And finally, it got to me. I said, "Wow, I got to do something to help her." And I said, "What's the problem?" I said, "Maybe you want to go down into the world, but nobody will help you." And I said, "Okay, I'll help you. I'll take you down into the world." And she stopped crying then. But she wouldn't stop crying until I said that. She would not stop crying, and it wore down my resistance, you know. That's her. That's Sri Sri Nanavayama, in the guise of your little sister, you know, or someone, you know, like that, but not as a mother, but as a little sister. You expect mother to take care of you. You don't expect to take care of your mother. But if your little sister is just crying inconsolably, you say, "Hey, sis, you know, what can I do for you? You know, let me help you out. What can I do for you?" And if she says, "Can you help me with this?" You say, sure, I'll do it. I don't want to see you brokenhearted like this." So that's her. And, you know, the world needs her. The world needs her right now. We absolutely need her. And remember, it will happen. It will happen. She told me it would happen. I don't know how she's going to do it, but it will happen. And hallucination is more often than not hallucinating the absence of what's there. Okay, hallucinating the absence of what's really there. This is very, very key. Very, very key. And I never thought of that till this taping this video. I never thought of it like that. I see, oh my gosh, that's like the key to the kingdom, isn't it? Key to the kingdom. In fact, doubt is a hallucination of the absence of reality. That's what it is. Jesus says all of conditioned existence is a dream. It's really a hallucination. But we're hallucinating the absence of reality. That's what we're doing. We're doubting that reality is present. That's a hallucination. We're doubting that reality is present. Hallucinating its absence. Now, she was all red. She was all red, dressed in red, which to me meant she's totally ready. She's totally ready. Get that? She's ready. She's ready to do it. She's ready to do it. And it was after that dream, a while after that, I came across these pictures, you know, and saying, folks, we have an ally. We have a unbeatable ally, actually. Time to call on that ally. You know, this ally is in alliance with what we really are. not hallucinating the absence of what we are. And time to call upon this ally. Time to call, because she has all the tricks up her sleeve that we need. And she'll use them. She showed that she'll use them. This is the thing. I studied her life so much, and she used whatever expedients were needed. She used them, but in a beautiful, creative, sublime way. So, she got her way. She got her way. Which means she helped us. She helped us. That was her way. Her will was to help us. And she found a way to do so. One way or the other. So the record is clear on that. The record is clear. Very clear. Person of super action. Is a Dharma king of super action. In terms of a whirlwind. She can be a whirlwind of action. And simply deal with unlimited number of problems at the same time and have it all work out properly. You know, people just remarked just they've never, it's just so extraordinary. So extraordinary. And she, many occasions, she fed vast multitudes out of seemingly no food at all. No food at all. The food never ran out. Food never ran out. Same with Jesus. Same. Whatever needs to happen, it happens. Whatever needs to happen, happens. And so, we can keep on hallucinating her absence, or we can decide, you know what, I'm going to stop hallucinating her absence. It's time. She's never been absent. She says, where can I go? Where can I go to? You say, I can be absent. Where can I be absent to? Where can I be absent to? I'm everywhere. How can I be absent to any of you? She says, it's impossible. She says, I can never be absent to any of you. So it's time for us to stop hallucinating her absence. Okay? Stop hallucinating her absence. And people, you know, whatever. I said I'd help her out, so, you know, there's no more courtesy calls. You know, the time for courtesy calls, it's not the time for it. You know, it's not the time for it. It's not the time for it. I have to realize that, you know. I made a courtesy call yesterday, today, but we can't harbor doubts about what we do. You know, it's do or die right now kind of situation. You can't harbor doubts under these circumstances, you know. You have to upset the apple cart. It has to be upset. People have to realize the severity of the situation, and they are faced with a choice. Are we going to keep hallucinating the absence of God and play right into the hands of the parasites, or are we going to drop that hallucination of the absence of God and start experiencing the presence of God in miraculous ways, so to speak? It seems miraculous to us because we think that the hallucinating the absence of God is God. You know, that God created us to hallucinate the absence of God, which is not true. That's absurd. That's absurd. That's absolutely absurd. God did not create us for that. People, we hear so much. Well, you understand exactly what I'm saying. I don't need to elaborate on it. It's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. I don't care what anyone says, in any historical persons, blah, blah, blah. If they say otherwise, they're wrong. They're mistaken. God did not create us to imagine, hallucinate the absence of God, okay? And the absence of what we are, because we are God. God shared itself with all of us continuously. So, you know, the battle's on. Battle's on. March 1st, the battle is on. It's a battle of, you know, to hallucinate or not hallucinate is the battle. And many people are enthralled by their hallucination, thinking it they're more powerful than God because they can make God disappear. No, we're just hallucinating the absence of God. They're still there. And they're enthralled with the capacity to hallucinate in this way. But, you know, we've been there and done that, and enough is enough. You know, if this causes the absence of Sri Sri Anandamayi, then I'm, you know, against it. It's enough is enough. It's causing the absence of her, hallucinating her absence. That's no good. It's no good anymore. I don't like that. That's nothing to be proud of. It really is it. Yeah, it's something to be ashamed of, actually. I mean, we're turning our back on her, hallucinating her absence. We're supposed to be proud of that. That's a shame. That's shameful. That's very shameful. And I admit it. I feel so ashamed, you know. Like, wow. This just cannot stand. This cannot stand. I will not stand for it, you know. This has to change. This has to change. I've been ignoring my little sister, you know. And that's not good. That's not right. It's not right. It's wrong. It's wrong. Flat out wrong. And wrong is never right. Wrong is never right. Lies are never true. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Lies are never true. Doesn't matter what kind of label we slap on them. They're still not true. They're still not true. So, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. March 1st. Awesome. Congratulations to all of us, right? Okay, so, next step. Next step. All ready for it. All ready for it. All ready for it. I had this amazing experience today. And I walked into the store. And you have to get a ticket in this store to be waited on. There's a lot of people there. So I pulled the ticket out of the machine, and I was hoping like for 44, because that's a little sort of an amazing anomaly that keeps coming up, 44. But I pulled 12. I said, 12, well, that's a great number too, 12 apostles, 12. So one of the clerks called it, saw me, and it was open. He's ready to wait on me, and he looked at me, and he said, "Okay, so," and he says, "Your number is, what's your number?" And he said, "I didn't say anything." He said, "What's your number?" And he said, 44, 44. I'm calling 44. You're 44." I said, that's amazing. Actually, I have 12. Why did you say my number was 44? And he said, I don't know. It just came into my head that you're 44. That was rather astonishing. And he says, it's just, you know, it's just one of those things. He's a very, very cool guy. He's very abstract-minded in some ways, very creative, very abstract-minded, very unusual guy. And he just could flow with stuff like this. He said, no, you're 44. I saw you and I just called out 44. I don't know what that means. but it keeps happening. And I'm not the only one that it happens to. Those who seem to be in tune with something, it keeps happening. You know, 44 and 144. 144 crops up all the time too. And the Bible says there's 144,000 that will be saved at the end of the cycle. Maybe it's referring to that. I don't know. Wow. 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 Right? It's extraordinary. It's extraordinary. Okay, one more time. Hallucination. Take it to be that we're hallucinating the absence of what's there. We're hallucinating that it's absent. What is there is, we're hallucinating that what is really there is actually absent. We're not seeing it. Okay? And it's time to drop that nonsense. It's time to drop that nonsense. So let's drop it together. Let's drop it together and help the world. Help the world right now. Okay? That's what's called for. All right. Very great. That's all for this one.